Am I audible or do you face any difficulty in hearing?
Is my
voice
no,
clear?
yeah.
Okay. So today is day 5, and before we go into today's topic, we'll just have a quick recap of topics we covered in the last session. In the last session, we covered topics like misconceptions about tester skill set. Here we talked about what are the skill set required for a tester and what exactly we need to improve upon. We talked about the domain knowledge and the application knowledge, development methodologies. All these things should be the necessary skill set for a tester. The general misconception about tester skill set is testing is very easy and there is no need of training and all. But actually, to test effectively, a person should have proper domain knowledge or business knowledge. He should be having the application knowledge, whatever application that he is going to test, he should be having good knowledge on that application, whether it is a web application or a client server application or a desktop application. He should have good knowledge on that, and he should have good communication skills and aptitude skills. And because in testing, because when it comes to testing, most of the times you will be relying on the documentation part. You will be preparing so many documents like test plan, test case document, test scenarios. You also write defects. When you write defects, you should be very clear, and your communication approach should be very straightforward, and it should be understandable to everybody. So, as a tester, a person should have good communication skills. And then we moved on to a topic called a test requirement gathering and analysis. Requirement gathering and analysis is the first phase of testing life cycle, where you go through the business requirement document. You try to understand the requirements, whether the requirement is clear, or is there any ambiguity in requirements, or is there any changes required to the current requirements. You go about all the requirements, and you come up with the suggestions or corrections that needs to be done on the BRD. The BRD is won by the business analyst. So when you go through the BRD and you raise some concerns on the BRD, it will be fixed by the business analyst. So when it is fixed, the business analyst will update the BRD document with the new version name, and he will send a new version of BRD document to all the team members, and the requirement analysis will continue. Here the major deliverable or the document that the testing team will be using is the clarification log. A clarification is log is a Excel sheet where you will maintain all the queries raised by the team, and the resolution provided by business analyst team or the technical architect team, and you will also track any open issues or any application related queries also. You will also track the business related queries. All the queries that are related to a BRD document analysis will be tracked in a clarification log. So this will serve as a point where if anybody joins the team recently, or who joins the team after the beginning of the project, they can go through the clarification log, so that it's like frequently asked questions where you can find all the details about the application related requirements. So, clarification log is one of the document you'll be dealing during the test requirement analysis phase. The reason this test requirement analysis is important, because if you find a defect at this stage, that will reduce a lot of rework. And if you miss a defect at this stage, it will cost the team a lot of effort and a lot of time for fixing that particular defect or an issue which is missed during this phase. And and it was observed that 50% of the defects will be uncovered during test requirement analysis. So it is a very important stage where everybody needs to pay a very good attention on the requirement analysis. Unless they are not clear about the requirements, they should not go about the testing. So once the requirement analysis is complete and everybody is clear about the requirements, the next step in the testing life cycle is the test strategy preparation. This strategy is a document, it's a very high level document wherein it can be an organization level document or a project level document. The main purpose of test strategy is in this document, as a team or as an organization, we'll draft some standards and processes that we follow for our testing. So as part of test strategy document, we'll be documenting details about test scope, which all items will be coming into our scope or which are not in scope for our testing. And we also talk about acceptance criteria. Acceptance criteria is a major item in a test strategy document, which defines what is the criteria that should be satisfied, which will enable the customer to accept the product. So unless the criteria is satisfied, the customer won't be ready to accept the product or the application that we have developed or tested. So acceptance criteria will define that particular condition or a particular milestone that we need to achieve in order to accept the product by the customer. So acceptance criteria is one important section that you will be drafting as part of test strategy document. And apart from that, you will be having details about test objectives, what are we going to achieve through this testing, and we also talk about the roles and responsibility, and here we will be listing all the stakeholder details and what are the roles and responsibilities of each and every stakeholder. If he is a tester, he is responsible for testing the application. If he is a testing manager, he is responsible for coordinating with the test team and the process. He keeps on following up with the team and try to avoid any hurdles that will be coming during their testing and all. And after that, we have sections like communication approach, configuration management, and the testing approach. And all these sections will differ based on the organization that they are going to work on. The test strategy template will vary based on your project, based on the organization that you are going to work on. So at a high level, there are certain sections that are common across all the organizations, but there is no standard template for test strategy. It varies based on the need, based on the project and all. So if your project is an automation project, then you will talk about automation details in test strategy. And if you have a matrix to capture, you will give the matrix details in the test strategy. And at a high level, for any test strategy, the common sections will be the test scope, test objective, acceptance criteria, roles and responsibilities of the stakeholders, and what type of communication approach that we will be following. And if we have any matrix that we are capturing, then we will cover that also. And we also cover details about configuration management, because testing involves a lot of documents. It is important to track all the changes. So configuration management is a concept where we track all the documentation versions and all. So configuration management concept, and if there is any tool that we are going to use as part of configuration management. And we also talk about the risk analysis, risk mitigation, and if there is a risk appetite, what amount of risk that the team is ready to accept, that is risk appetite. So all these details will track and will draft in a test strategy document. And a major important characteristic of test strategy document is it's a static document. You won't change the test strategy document during the life cycle. Once it is drafted and approved, it is static. No more changes to the test strategy document. And as I said, it is an organizational level or project level document. So you won't go about much details about testing. You talk at a high level. You draft the details at a high level. And the test plan is a document where we give all the details. So today's topic is a test plan preparation. Before we go into test plan preparation and all, do you have any questions on the test strategy and the requirement analysis topics? Anyone? Do you have any questions? Okay, I have a question. Do we cover schedules and resourcing details in test strategy, like the timelines and all? Anyone?
No.
Oh, we don't cover schedules. What about milestones? Do we cover milestone details in the strategy?
Yeah, we set to milestones, but we can't, you know, time set maybe time, because it can be changed, right? If there is any change in a document or something, then schedule can be changed. So.
Yeah, you are correct. We can have the milestones at a high level. We can say that these are the documents that we are going to deliver, and these are the deliverables from a testing team's standpoint. But we cannot give the timelines in a test strategy, because it is a high level document. The timelines can change at any time. So test strategy is a static document, and that is the reason we are not giving any resource level details or the resource skill set level details and the schedules that we are going to follow. All these details we are not giving in test strategy. All these details will come as part of test plan. So any other questions do you have on test strategy? It is not a mandatory document. The test strategy can be part of test plan. Some organizations will have a single document called test plan, and some of the test strategy sections are added into test plan itself. And some organizations will have a different documents for test strategy and the test plan, but there is a significant difference between test strategy and test plan. So if you are preparing two documents, you should be aware of the difference. Test strategy is a high level document, test plan is a detail level document. And test strategy is a static document wherein you won't make any changes during the testing life cycle. The test plan is a dynamic document. It keeps on changing during the life cycle. These are some basic differences. There are more. We'll talk about the differences later. But as of now, test strategy is a high level document, and it is a static document. Okay, if you are clear on these two topics, we can move on to the next topic, test plan. The topics that we are going to cover today are prerequisites to test planning, and the guidelines to writing the test plan. And finally, we talk about the test plan standards and what are the sections that will be there in a test plan, in any test plan. Just like test strategy, we don't have a standard template for test plan. It may vary based on your organization. The templates can be different, but the content that we are going to cover as part of test plan will be same. The section names and the order can be different for organization. So we'll talk about the sections and the content that we are going to cover as part of test plan. There are some standard test plan templates from IEEE, and some of the standard organizations are there. Some people will follow such standard templates. Some people will have their own template. So it depends on their organization need. So there is no standard template or a hard and fast rule that you should be using this kind of template and all. So you can have your own template, which will cover the basic details about our testing life cycle and all. So we'll go about the sections in the test plan standard. The first topic is the prerequisites to test planning. So before we start drafting a test plan document, there are some items that the testing team or the test manager should be aware of. So before drafting, the team should be aware of the test objectives. The test objectives is nothing but what exactly are we going to achieve by testing certain product. So if we are testing a adjudication web application, what is our objective? Our objective could be automating the claim processing. Maybe previously we are doing it manually. So by incorporating this particular web application that does adjudication, we may be automating around 80% of the claim processing. So that could be our objective. Or our objective can be based on the quality. Maybe earlier out of 80% of the claims, only 50% of the claims are paid with 100% quality, or the processing is not so much effective. So we may be increasing the quality of the processing. The 50% may be increased to 70. All these business level achievements or business level milestones will be tracked as part of test objectives. What exactly we are going to achieve by doing this testing. The next one is the acceptance criteria. This one we talked about in test strategy preparation. So we should be aware of the acceptance criteria. So it defines when exactly we can stop testing. So once we meet this acceptance criteria, the customer is ready to accept the product. So it is an agreement between the customer and the service provider. Service provider is nothing but the team that is going to develop this software and the team that is going to test this software and all. So there will be an agreement saying that if we can achieve 70% of automation of this healthcare claim, we'll accept the product. That could be one of the criteria. And the other criteria can be if you have covered all the critical functionalities of a claim processing application testing, then we are ready to accept the product. So such kind of statements can be made by the customer, and if we meet that criteria, then they will be accepting the product. So acceptance criteria, we should be aware of those statements or the agreement before going for a test planning. And the third one is the assumptions. So assumptions is an important section wherein we list out all our because something that is not mentioned or something that is not drafted as part of BRD, we should be listing here. One good example will be before testing, we will assume that the development team will provide us the application or the coded application within the scheduled time. That is one of the assumptions, because it won't be this particular statement will not be there in your BRD document or will not be there in any of the document, but our assumption is that development team will provide us the coded product, then only we can start. So that could be one of the assumptions. The other assumptions could be the testing team that is going to perform the testing on application. We assume that they have good knowledge on healthcare insurance product or healthcare insurance claim processing details. So that is one assumption. So all these things are drafted in test plan document. So before we go about test planning, we should be aware of the assumptions. So assumptions plays an important role when there is an issue or whenever there is an escalation happening on the project level, deliverables and all. So the first or the starting point for their root cause analysis is assumption section. So assumptions, we draft something that is not mentioned formally. Those things will draft as part of assumptions. So, and it is important to get approval for all these assumptions. And the fourth one is the people issues. Here majorly we get the details about the resources that are available and their skill set. Even we get the details about their attitudes towards testing. So all these details we should be aware of before going for the test planning. And the last one is a constraint. Constraints, there will be n number of constraints for any project. There will be constraints on environment side. There will be constraint on tester skill set side. Maybe the people that we have, the resource pool that we have, they may not be having enough knowledge on application, or all these people are having knowledge on banking domain. And the application that we are going to testing is related to healthcare domain. That could be one constraint. And if we are using any tools, any testing tools or any automation tools that we are going to use, maybe the team is not having enough experience on the automation side. So all these things will come as part of constraints. So we should be aware of all these constraints. So if we get all these details, then we should be having good knowledge on what exactly we can achieve and what exactly we have in hand. So, test objectives, acceptance criteria, assumptions, people issues, constraints. So, these are some of the prerequisites to test planning. We should be tracking all these details before we go about test planning, because we will be drafting the test plan based on these five items. So, do you have any questions on this thing, prerequisites to test planning? Anyone have a question? Acceptance criteria, it was there in test strategy. So if your organization is preparing test strategy document, it will be covering most of these items. Test objective, we were covering in test strategy. Acceptance criteria was there. Assumptions was not there. And people issues, constraints, these are the three new items that are coming up, which we will be covering as part of test plan. But before we go about test plan, we should get the details about these three. If you already have a test strategy, the first two sections are already covered. Any questions on prerequisites? Okay, why do we talk about people issues here? As part of test planning, we should be talking about the schedules only, right? So when exactly we are going to deliver and all. Why do we need to get the details about people issues, like their attitudes and their communication expertise and all? Why are we talking about people's attitudes? Can anybody tell me why we are discussing about people issues here? Anyone?
Because testing is involved with the team.
Yeah, that the team resource level skill set and everything we are tracking, that is there. What could be the people issue generally? Can you give me one example? You have a team and you have around 10 folks working as part of team, and they all have a good skill set and they all have a good communication skill set. What could be the people issue that will be coming up from your team side? Any example on people issues? Yeah.
It can be any like anything deliverables like schedule date or anything, or regarding the meeting.
It can be related to their presence. We have a deadline and some of the team members require some leave. That can be a challenge for us. If they are going on vacation, that will be a challenge for us. And if we are moving away from a deadline and the management says that you should work extra 2 hours per day to achieve those targets and all, and out of 10, 9 or 4 are not ready to stretch for those 2 hours because they have their own personal dependencies and personal engagement. So all these things, planning and the steps that we are going to take to make sure that delivery is in time, all these things will depend on the people. So their availability and their the dedication towards the application delivery and all. So anything that affects our delivery and anything that points to the people's availability and all these things will come as part of people issues. Sometimes there can be instances like the development team, if we log a defect, the development team come back and say that this is not a valid defect and you are not testing properly, your test data preparation is wrong. So in such cases, some of the testers may get appended. They say that whatever we are testing good, and you should not be talking about our testing approach and also. It depends on their attitude, and some people may take it as a positive way, and some people may go on about it. So people issues are important. If somebody's attitude is not right, then we should be as a team lead or a team manager, we should be addressing that. And we should provide them proper way of communication. So all these things we cover as part of people issues. So if you are clear about the prerequisites, we'll move on to the next section of test planning. The next one is the guidelines to writing the test plan. So these are some of the things that one should keep in mind before writing the test plan. So the first one is a start early. So when exactly we start writing the test plan, the best thing is if you start early, that will give you more inputs for test planning. So the best time to start writing the test plan is when you start the requirement analysis. You should parallelly start writing the test plan also. So ideally, a requirement analysis stage is the best starting point for the test plan preparation. And the next one is keep the test plan flexible. So as we talked about, the test plan is a dynamic document. It keeps on changing during the testing life cycle. So a test plan should be flexible. So when you are writing something in a test plan document like automation tools, if you are writing about automation tools, you should be flexible about changing the automation strategy as well. In the initial stages, like when you are gathering the requirements, the team or the management might feel like we may use QTP, But when it comes to test design or test case preparation, you come to know that QTP is very expensive, and that kind of test cases that you are drafting is not possible through QTP. The team may take a decision saying that we may go for the Selenium tool. So in that case, you will update the test plan, and you will write like we are going to use the Selenium tool as part of our test automation. So the test plan should be flexible, and there should not be any resistance toward test plan changes. So all the changes will be and should be accepted into the test plan. So when you start very early, at the requirement analysis stage only, and that you, while you are going through the testing life cycle till we start the test execution, there will be a lot of changes happening to the test plan. One major impact on test plan would be requirement change. Requirement changes can come anytime. So because while you are doing the requirement analysis, one of the team member may come up with an ambiguous requirement, and he might say that this one is not testable or this one is not clear, we should update the BRD. So that will affect test plan. How it affects? In test plan we have sections called in scope and out of scope. So when you are drafting those in scope and out of scope items, your baseline point will be your requirements. So based on the requirement only, you will draft all the in scope items and out of scope items. When you change the requirements, your in scope out of scope items may change. So that is the way test plan works, and anything that affects the BRD will affect test plan. Anything that affects your test case document will affect test plan. So a test plan is a detailed level document which guides us through our entire testing life cycle. So we should start early, and we should be flexible about keeping or tracking the changes through test plan. And the third one is review the test plan frequently. So a review should be happening, and not just test plan, review is important for all the document you maintain throughout testing life cycle. We review BRD document, and if you have any questions, we raise it through clarification log. And we review test strategy document before we get the approval. We also review test cases, test scenarios, and even the defect documentation that we prepared. Everything gets reviewed. So similarly, test plan is also requires review, and it requires a frequent review. Whenever there is a change, a review should be there. One of your peers should review that test plan, and there should be a proper approval happening for all the changes that we make to the test plan. And the fourth one is keep the test plan concise and readable. The reason for this statement is test plan is a detailed level document. It doesn't mean that you will write essays inside the test plan. It should be concise. The main intent of test plan is it should give a quick snapshot of your testing project. It should talk about the schedules, it should talk about the team that is going to perform the testing and their skill set, and what exactly they are going to deliver, and the automation tools and all, and then scope items. The risks involved and the assumptions we have, all these details will be drafted pretty concise and in a readable format. You cannot write paragraphs or 2-3 page document for single sections. So it should be concise and it should be a readable format. And the fourth one is calculate the planning effort. So this one is important. When you are charging hours or when you are billing for your particular testing effort, test planning effort will also be part of that testing effort. So if you are charging if you are saying that 100 hours is my testing effort, and then test planning effort should be part of that 100 hours. So out of 100 hours, your test planning effort could be 5 to 6 hours, including the review and including the changes that you make and all. So it could be 5 to 6 hours. So you should be calculating the planning effort also. So this planning effort will depend on the changes that will be coming towards your testing team. It can be requirement change, or it can be your resource level changes. There can be instances that some of the resources may leave the project and they may join some other project during your test execution and all. So at that time, your test plan should be changed. It should be flexible to accept any new skill set or to remove any new skill set from the team and all. So all these things will be tracked as part of test plan. So generally we'll be having a project level plan which covers all the development related and design related and testing related details. But test plan is something, it's a project plan for testing team. So we call it as a test planning document. And the last one is that spend the time to do a complete test plan. There are instances like in most of the organizations, they follow a standard template. And when we have a template, the idea or the intent of the test lead or the manager is they just maintain the test plan for the documentation purpose or audit purpose. So that should not be the case. A test plan should be made as per your team and should be drafted as per your team's requirements. So if you have a template, it doesn't mean that you won't concentrate more on the sections. A template is just to give you an overview of how the test plan should be. But when you are drafting the test plan, you should review all the sections. If there is any section missing or if there is any section that needs to be added for your project related need, you should add it, and you should inform particular process owner who is owning the test plan templates and all. So you should spend much time on completing and writing the test plan, because if you have a good test plan, that means you have good control on the project. If you don't have a good test plan and you are doing the testing, at some point of time you get some issue, you won't find a solution if you don't have a test plan. The best example is the assumption section. If you don't draft the assumptions properly and you got some issue, and the first question you'll be getting from the management side is whether you have covered this as part of your assumptions, or did you assume something which is not there in the requirement document. Because the manager might assume that everybody in the team may be having all the skill set required for testing. The manager may be having around 50 member team, and when they start testing that particular application, the first assumption he should be listing is all the 50 team members are having good knowledge on the domain. So if he is not listing that particular assumption, and during the execution or at some point of testing life cycle, he comes to know that majority of team is not having good knowledge of the application, and it has been escalated by the customer or whoever is getting that deliverable, then it will be a negative impact on the test planning and the person who is owning the test plan. So that assumption should be listed there, and it should be a proper assumption. You cannot assume everything. So whatever you assume, it should be a proper one. You cannot assume something like one tester can do everything, you know. So assumption plays an important role whenever there is an escalation or complaints coming as part of a deliverable. So spending much time on test plan will give us more control on the testing life cycle. And if you get, if you won't get some of the details like actual schedules, so at the beginning of your testing, like requirement analysis, you may not be having clear picture about that testing schedules, and you may not know when the development team is sending as the coded product. So then the best way to capture those things is to have a tentative date. So you can get the tentative date from the development team, and you can incorporate those tentative dates, and you can also put some comments saying that these are tentative dates and this may change at a later point of time. So the idea is you should get all the details. They may not be a baseline details or as I said, the schedule or the timeline. It may not be a final timeline or it may not be a strict timeline. You can have the flexible timelines for schedules. And you can draft it as part of test plan, and whenever you get some changes on those sections, you will make those changes. That's the reason it is going to be flexible. And if there is any change coming and that is affecting your testing, the first point to make those changes is test plan. So test plan document plays an important role. Having a test plan gives you more control on the project. It is a dynamic document, and it has some sections. We talk about the sections in the next topic on the test plan standards. Any questions here about the guidelines and all? So we'll move on to the test plan standard, where we talk about the sections that will be there as part of test plan. So test plan standard is as I said, there's no standard template. So the sections that we are going to discuss now are common sections that will be there in any template, or if any organization is following the standard template from their point of view, they will basically have these sections. The basic focus of this document should be on what to test and how to test, when to test, and who will do what test. So these are the four basic characteristics of a basic details that we are going to cover as part of test plan. What to test, this one we will be covering as part of our in scope and out of scope. So where we get a clarity on what exactly we are going to testing and what exactly we are not testing. So in scope and out of scope, we will get the details from the BRD. So everything depends on the BRD document. So if we have any functional requirements, we will make it. If we have any non-functional if our team is not supporting any non-functional requirements, when I say non-functional requirements, it can be a performance testing related, or it can be security testing related, which our team is not expert on, then we may make those items as out of scope. Some other team may make them as a in scope for them. So what to test is also called as in scope and out of scope items for our testing team. And the next one is a how to test. So the testing can be manual, it can be automation, or it can be a performance testing. So how exactly we are testing that requirement. So that we are going to cover as part of test plan. The test plan gives you an idea of how exactly we are approaching the testing. So when you draft test strategy, we'll draft our strategy at a organization level or a project level. Whereas in test plan, we draft those details at a testing team level. So how exactly our team is approaching the testing, how many cycles we are going to have, and what exactly we are going to cover in each and every cycle, all these things we'll cover as part of test plan. And the third one is when to test. Here we are talking about the schedules, when exactly we are going to start the testing, and how many days we will be conducting the cycle one, where it's 1 month or 2 months we are testing, or when exactly we are going to finish the testing. All these things we cover as part of test plan. And the fourth one is who will do what test. So it is nothing but the roles and responsibilities. So if there is an automation testing or a performance testing, it should be the responsibility of the performance testing team. Or if there is a functional requirements, a normal tester will do the functional requirement testing. If there is something that requires a specific skill like coding, if there is a white box testing need, who will do the testing? The tester may take help from the developer, or he can get another tester or another resource who is having knowledge on the coding and all. So all these details we capture as part of test plan. Basic focus will be on these four items, and whereas in test strategy we won't be going about this much details. We'll talk about at a high level scenarios only. So test plan document will go into the detail, and all these four items, and if any change is coming up, we should be flexible to change the details that we drafted for this four section. Now we'll go about actual sections from a test plan standard template point of view. The basic idea is in any template or in any standard templates of any organizations, a test plan covers these four items, which is the what to test, how to test, when to test, and who will do what test. So all these four will be covered in any test plan. So this is just a layman terminology. Now we will be going about actual terminology or actual vocabulary that we'll be using as part of test plan. So are you clear on this one? This slide. If you're clear on this side, then you should be in a good position to differentiate between test strategy and test plan. The difference between test plan and test strategy is a major question that will be asked in all the interviews. If they ask you about test planning, they will definitely ask you about test strategy and the difference. Shall I move on to the next slide? Are you clear about this major focus of test plan document? Do you have any questions? Anyone? Okay, we'll move on to the next slide. So these are the sections of a test plan document. The first one being the test scope. Test scope is a section wherein we draft the in scope items and out of scope items. So how do we come up with the in scope and out of scope items? So basically, when we get a BRD document, the requirements will be listed there. We'll be having a requirement ID, and requirements are categorized into different things like business requirements, functional requirements, and there can be requirements that's called user requirements. So based on the categorization and our analysis of the requirement, there are requirements that are testable, and there can be requirements which are not feasible for test. So when there is a requirement which is not feasible for testing, that will be an out of scope for us. So before we decide on whether it is in scope or out of scope, we should be having a dialogue with the business analyst and the development team, and only after the dialogue and only after the mutual understanding of that particular requirement, we should be drafting that requirement as out of scope or in scope. So when we have a discussion with a business analyst or a technical architect during the requirement analysis phase, the idea is to understand what exactly we can test and what we cannot test. So these things we'll draft as part of test scope. To give an example, we got a BRD for one of the web application, which provides us our credit card statement. So the intent of developing this particular web application is any customer who is owning a credit card, they can log in and they can check their e-statements. So the credit cards is a different wing of any financial institution. If it is a bank, it can support credit cards, it can support savings accounts, and it can support home loans, and all these are different wings of a financial institution. So when we are testing this credit card application, the customer can be a regular customer, or he may be holding only the credit card. So when we are analyzing this BRD, the point of testing whether this customer is a regular customer or he is a person who is holding only the credit card from that institute, these things would be out of scope for us. The only in scope item for us is any customer, whether he is a regular or a customer who is holding only the credit card, or a customer who is related to this particular bank or financial institute only through this credit card. Any customer should be able to log in to that particular website and check the e-statements. The basic prerequisite is the person should be holding a card. He can be a regular customer or a part-time customer. So these things will be out of scope. The customer's characteristics will be out of scope. The only characteristic that we are testing is whether he is holding a card or not. So this kind of segregation between the requirements, whether it is in scope or out of scope, depend on the business requirements, and the business analyst team will be helping us in differentiating between these two. And there can be instances where a particular requirement may not be testable. The one we talked about in previous sessions was by looking at the web application, the user should be happy about it, or the user should feel comfortable about the colors that are there on a web application, which we cannot test. It's about feeling. So those things, if those kind of requirements are documented as part of BRD, we'll just move them to our out of scope bucket. Such things we cannot test. It's about users' perceptions and all. So we may test that whether the logo is having the three basic colors defined or not, but we cannot say that these colors will make the customer happy or not. So that's how we differentiate between in scope and out of scope. So in test plan, starting section would be defining these scope items. So it is nothing but the requirements. We are just segregating them into two buckets. One is in scope, other one is out of scope. So once we are clear with the in scope and out of scope items, we should get our objective. If we have the in scope items, what exactly we are going to achieve by testing these in scope items? So we should have that end result. The test objective could be a simple paragraph stating the business value that we are going to provide. So, the same example, by having a web application for generating this e-statements, the business value could be we may be closing down the paper statements, which saves a lot of money. And we won't be emailing the statements, which also saves a lot of logistic efforts. So all these things add value to the business and saves a lot of money. So by having a single web application, we'll be reducing a lot of effort on mailing all the statements and following up with the customers and all. In the web application, we can set reminders, which will ease the process and which will add value to the business, and anybody can log in and at any time and get the statement. So all these business objectives and what exactly we are going to achieve by testing those in scope items will be drafted here. We here in test objective, we talk about the business value in terms of dollars. We can also write that the savings by implementing this particular requirement would be $1 million, or we talk about approximate business value, it could be $1 million or $250,000 like that. So test objective is what exactly we are going to achieve by testing these requirements and all. So it can be a business value, or it can be a customer satisfaction related item, or you can make statements like this will improve the customer satisfaction level. So right now they out of 10 their satisfaction levels are 4. By implementing such web application and providing them a 24/7 support on this statement, the customer satisfaction level may go up to 6% and all. So all these things we draft as part of test objectives. So from where you get these details, you will get it from the BRD. The business requirement document talks about these business values, and when you write test objectives, you can take the BRD as a baseline, and you can get the details from BRD and draft it here. It's like our goal of testing, why we are testing these items, the objective. So once we draft the scope items and the objective, and the third one is assumptions, where as we talked, we list out all the assumptions. Basic assumptions about our environments and our people. If there is any skill set that should be there with the people, we should list out here. The basic one of the assumptions could be their skill set, like all the people working as part of this testing team should have will be having good communication skills. That's one of the assumptions we'll be having. And because it is part of the recruitment process, when they're recruiting that particular person, he should be having good communication skills. And when he is assigned to a particular project, we assume that he is having, or the person is having, certain skills. So all these assumptions will be listed here. And one major assumption is that the development team will provide us the product in time. So you will see this assumption in almost every test plan document. So unless they provide us the coded application, we cannot start testing. So we assume that they will provide the application within the time. So that is one of the assumptions. Similarly, you may have different assumptions. So it is important to capture all the assumptions. You cannot simply ignore one or two assumptions. Sometimes you may feel that this is not an item that needs to be drafted in test plan, but if you are ignoring that, at some point of time it will come as an escalation the client side or the management side, and you will be at fault. So that's the reason, whether it's a small one or a bigger one, you should draft it. Okay, and after you prepare all the assumptions, you will go about the risk analysis. So risk is something that we may anticipate. So as part of assumption, we are drafting something like the development team will be providing us the coded product within the scheduled time. So if it is not providing us, if the development team is not ready to provide us the coded application within the time, what is the risk? These things we capture as part of risk analysis. As part of risk analysis, we list out all the risks involved in the test execution or test planning. So the testing execution, what are the risks that we may encounter? Major risk.
Hello?
Yes?
We cannot able to hear it properly.
What about now? Are you able to hear?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it clear now?
No.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, are you able to hear me now?
It's little low.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes.
Is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay. So, we were talking about the assumptions. The major assumption that we have is the development delivery of coded product in time for testing team. If it is not met, it can be a risk. As part of risk analysis, we talk about what if they are not delivering the product in time. What is the mitigation plan for it? So it affects our schedules. If for testing, if they have given a 2 month timeline and the development team is already delayed delivering the product by 2-3 weeks, it affects the testing schedules and we may end up having only 1 month of testing. So in that case, what will your plan be? The risk analysis stage, we talk about risk mitigation also. Wherein we have a secondary plan whenever our testing life cycle or testing project is facing some issues with the assumptions, we should be having plan B. Those things will be drafted as part of risk analysis. So there is a discussion on who should be involved in risk analysis. So ideally, all the team members should be involved as part of risk analysis. Whenever we are going about a testing project, so after the requirement analysis, all the team members should sit together and try to draft all the risks involved as part of testing this project. Some of the major risks will be the schedules, because always testing teams will end up having lesser time for testing. Because we have a dependency with the development team, and unless they won't deliver that particular product, a testing cannot start. We may be ready with all the test cases and test scenarios, even the test data, but if the application is not there, execution cannot start. So this is one of the biggest risks. And some of the risks that will be there are people related risks. One good example is that we have a team of 10 and 2-3 people may get an ad hoc leave, like they may be having some sick leaves kind of thing, which will pose a risk on our deliverables. So all the leave plans and all should be tracked as part of our test plan, and their availability will be tracked as part of test plan. So whenever somebody is leaving, we should have a backup plan, and we should have a backup for the resources. So as part of risk, we may and we can track all these details. Anything that affects our deliverable is a risk. So identifying risk is a major task for all the team members. It's not just one or two person's activity. So all the team members should be part of it, and they should be having good knowledge on the requirements, and they should be able to identify the risk. And one classic example of risk is environment. So if the environment is not stable, whatever we are testing is of no use. So this could be a major risk for all the testing teams. So before we go about testing, we should come to an agreement with the test environment team, saying that unless the environment is stable, it should not be provided as for testing. When we are preparing data and all in the environment, if we are doing work on an unstable environment, whatever we are doing on that unstable won't be taken as a baseline or won't be taken as a final. If you log a defect on an unstable environment, the development team won't accept those defects. So risk analysis plays an important role, and here you will identify the risk. And you will prepare a plan B for all the risks. If that risk is posing as a threat, how we are doing about it. And we also talk about management. And there are certain risks that the team will be ready to accept. horizontal is the schedule. If they are not going to deliver it and we have a strict deadline of 2 months of testing, if the development team has delayed it for 1 week, we may end up not covering all the functionalities. So when we are getting the product at a delayed time, we should communicate this to all the stakeholders, saying that we are getting only 1 month of testing time. So we may not cover all the functionalities. However, we may provide 80% of coverage, so that most of the defects will be taken care. So based on the deadlines, our ability of testing is 80%. So 20% will be our risk for application testing. So if the customer is ready to accept that 20% risk, we'll deliver it. Not, then we'll try to look for some other alternative or some other data. We may add few more resources to the project.
Excuse me.
Yes.
There is a lot of disturbance with your voice.
Right now?
Sometimes it's okay, but it goes back again. Do you think so?
How about now?
Yeah. Sounds fine, yeah.
Okay. Is it for everybody? Or?
I think so.
Me too.
Okay.
Voice is breaking up.
Almost now. Is it clear? It is still breaking.
It's clear.
Hello. It's clear?
Yeah.
Okay. What we were talking about the timeline. So when we have a lesser timeline, we may end up having less coverage of testing. So it depends on the dialogue we have with the customer and all. So we can say that we will cover only 80% of our requirements. So if you are good with 80% of requirements and ready to accept 20% of risk, then we will deliver this product. If the customer is not ready, then we should have a backup plan, like adding resources to our pool or adding resources to the testing team, and try to finish up all the 100% requirements for testing and all. So all these backup plans and plan B's, everything will be covered as part of risk analysis. And there can be risks like our office may be closed due to some natural calamity, and that day there won't be any productivity. So what is the backup plan for such things? So even these kind of risks will be included as part of risk analysis section. So it will be identified, a risk will be identified, and we will draft a mitigation plan for that. And if there is an existing risk, we'll try to reduce the risk. There is no possibility of avoiding the risk. If you avoid a risk, it may show up at a later point of your life cycle. So if you just ignore something, it may come up at a later point of time. So we should address all the risks, and we should have a backup plan for all the risk items. So once we are done with the risk analysis, the next thing is a test design. So test design is a section wherein we'll talk about what kinds of testing we are going to do. Whether we are going to do a system testing, or do we have integration testing, or do we perform automation testing? If we are performing automation testing, what kind of techniques that we are going to follow? So if you are doing a system testing, whether it is a black box testing or white box testing, so all kinds of details we'll draft as part of test design. And here we will also draft details like how many cycles of testing we are going to do, and in which order we are going about this testing. So we have a different testing techniques like regression testing, and we may do some testing like ad hoc testing. So what is the order? So the basic idea is how you are going to approach your test execution. Generally, whenever we get the coded product from development team, the first thing that we do is ad hoc testing. So we just go on to the application. We won't follow any test cases and all. So we just go on to the application and try to break the system. The reason for ad hoc testing is the system stability will be tested during this phase. If it is not stable, we won't start testing using the test cases. So to start with the test cases, the system should be stable. So to test whether it is stable or not, the technique we can use is ad hoc testing. Just go on to the application and play around it and try to break the system and all. So if it is fine, reasonably stable, then we can start our another testing technique, which is the system testing, where we have the test cases. We'll go by step, and we'll have a proper approach of testing and all. So that this can be one of the test designing aspect, starting up with ad hoc and then going to system testing. And there can be another kind, like whenever we get a build, the team will run the regression test cases first. The reason is to make sure that any new changes made as part of this delivery are not affecting the previous functionalities. So that's the main objective of regression testing. So before we go about current scenario, we'll just test that the previous functionalities are not affected by the latest changes. So they can do regression testing first and then go about the recent test cases. And there can be instances where the team won't be doing any ad hoc or regression. They'll just straight away go and test the current release test cases and current release functionalities and all. So it depends on the project needs and our testing objective. So the design can be drafted as part of test plan, and the designing techniques or the approach depends on the project need or the testing objective. So as part of test design, we talk about all these details, the number of cycles we are going to have and the type of techniques we are going to use, and if anything requires, if any new technique needs to be added, we can add it here. There can be projects that require alpha testing and beta testing. All these are types of testing. We'll talk about details later. For now, I'll just give an overview of what is beta testing. Beta testing is something like we'll test it from the user perspective. You may be heard of beta releases of Gmail, Yahoo Mails and all. So a beta release is something which is not a final product, but which looks similar to the product and it is given to the end user. So the end user will use that product for 1 or 2 months, and if he finds any bugs in that, he'll report it. And once the producer or the person who is providing the product, whether it's a Google or some other organization, if they're confident, they'll release the finalized version. So a beta version is something that gives us the customer's perspective, that gives us the user level defects and all. So if our testing team needs to do such beta testing, we'll write that as part of test design section. So it depends on customer's needs and the requirements that we have and how we are approaching the testing execution, and all these details will be drafted as part of test design. So are you clear about all these 5 sections? We have few more sections coming up. So if you are clear about first 5 sections, we'll move to the next slide. Do you have any questions on these first 5 sections? Any questions? Okay, we'll move on to the next slide. The next section that we'll be talking about is roles and responsibilities. So as part of testing, we'll be having different kinds of roles. A person can be an automation tester, or he can be a functional tester, or he can be a testing lead or a manager. So we'll define what are the roles and responsibilities of each and every individual here. So we, if he is an automation tester, he should be able to prepare the automation framework for a testing project. And if anybody, if anyone wants to reuse certain components, that person will be the point of contact. All the roles and responsibilities will be listed as part of test plan. And these roles and responsibilities are specific to our testing project. These are not related to the job he is performing as part of an overall organization. These roles and responsibilities are specific to testing of that particular project. Let's say my testing project is related to a mainframe's operating system, JetOS, and it requires knowledge on COBOL programming. These are all my assumptions. And when I take a tester, his roles will be to test the mainframe application, he should be having knowledge. That's my assumption. And his roles will be testing those screens, mainframe screens. Mainframe screens are different from our normal Windows screens. So he should be a very, he should be having knowledge on that. So his roles will be testing those screens. And so one major item in roles and responsibilities could be mentoring. If there is a person who is having very less knowledge on mainframes, one of the senior resource responsibility will be to train them or mentoring them on the new technologies or the, any technology that they are not aware of or they are not expertised on. So this responsibility also you can add as part of roles and responsibilities section, providing the training and providing the technical support to the people who are not well expertised on that particular application. These things also will be there. So that's the reason we said that it is a testing team level responsibility. It is not to do anything with your organization level job responsibility. It is testing team level responsibility and the role you are playing as part of testing. To give the difference, you may be a project manager as part of organization level, but when it comes to this testing project, you play as a testing manager. So you are assigned to a testing project, so you will play the role of a testing manager. So your roles will be different as part of testing manager. At a project management level, you will be providing project level status to various stakeholders or the management. That is, testing level manager will be focusing on the delivery of that particular product. Yes, you will be providing the reports to the management as usual, but you will be having additional responsibilities as a testing manager. So it depends on your testing project. So when we are defining roles and responsibilities, you should keep in mind that it's about our project and it's about that particular testing project. It's not about your overall roles. So you'll be having additional responsibilities when you're working in a particular project. The next the next section is test schedule and resources. So this is a section that that majorly differentiates between test strategy and test plan. So test schedule. So in the previous slide, we talked about test design, where we will be listing the number of cycles that we are going to have and all. So if we are having, let's say, 3 cycles, so what is the schedule? From which date to which date we are performing cycle 1, and from which date to which date we are performing cycle 2, and what is the span of cycle 3 testing? So all these details, we cover it as part of schedules. And the resources, how many resources will be part of cycle 1, how many resources will be part of cycle 2 and all these details should be covered as part of this section. So as I said, the schedules and the resource details may change, and there won't be a standard schedule. It depends on the development timeline. So in the initial stage, we provide the tentative timelines, and whenever there is a change, we keep on changing these schedules and resource level details. Some resources are, in my testing team, if 2 of the resources require an urgently, when they may leave the project, so in that time we should have a backup resource plan, and we should add few more resources to our project so that our deliverables won't get affected. So all these things will be taken care as part of this section. And when we talk about resources, we'll also track something called skill matrix. A skill matrix is it's a tabular format of on the first column we'll be having all the resource names, and on the subsequent columns we'll have a specific skill set whether he is having that skill set or not. So if my testing effort requires automation knowledge and it requires communication, so I'll be having two columns and I'll be marking whether the resource is capable of doing automation testing or whether his communication skills are good or not. So it's a matrix, just a tabular format, just to give an idea on what skill set we have for all the resources and all. So it will enable for good planning. If one of the resources is good at functional knowledge, we may be assigning tasks related to the functional aspect. If one of the resources is good at automation, we'll assign all the automation related tasks to these kinds of persons. If the person is good at communication, we'll make him as a voice of the team, and we'll try to put him on the calls and for defect triaging, or if any meetings happening, he'll be the person leading those meetings and all. So it depends on the skill set, we'll assign different responsibilities. So skill matrix is one thing that we'll draft in this section, test schedules and resources. As we talk schedules, we'll talk about the timelines and what exactly we are going to achieve during these timelines. So this is an important section, and it differentiates us, it differentiates the test plan from test strategy. And the next one is a test data management. So test data is a major testing. Most of the defects originate from test data. So unless you don't have a good testing data, whatever you are testing is it will not be giving any value or any justification on your testing side. So test data management is very important. So there are some best practices for test data management. Initially, the best example will be the adjudication application. So let's take an example of adjudication. This web application will perform adjudication functionalities of a claim. So when we are performing adjudication functionalities of a claim, let's say for this release we have incorporated a couple of changes in the adjudication process. We have incorporated changes like member eligibility validation, whether this member is part of our policy rules or not. This can be one of the changes. To test that, the data I require is the member's SSN, and it should be mapped to one of the policies, insurance policy. So this mapping should be there. When I'm testing that, I should have a good data on SSN related information as well as the policy related information. If I don't have the policy level information and I have only the member level information with me, I cannot go about testing. So I should get the data from both sides. The member details may be stored in a separate database, whereas the policy details may be stored in a separate database. But they should, when we are going about testing, we should get data from both the database and prepare our own test data. So major challenge will be after every release, the testing data will be deleted. The reason being, when we are testing, we may not be testing like production scenario. We may use junk data also. To give an example, if I have to test the login functionality, and the logins that I use may not be an actual production scenario. I may use different logins. I may use all special characters in the login. So all these things will be stored in our database like a junk data. So the database cleanup should be made before we start off testing or test data preparation. These are some of the best practices. I'll share one practice that we followed. generally we had two environments, two testing environments. How we are using these environments is like per year we have four releases, every quarterly release. So for first release we'll be using environment one, and for the coming release like quarter two we use environment two. And while we are using environment two, environment one will be cleaned up, like there won't be any data stored and all this maintenance activity will go on while we are using environment two. And when quarter three comes up we'll leave environment two and we'll use environment one again. So the advantage of having two environments is the changes coming from quarter one will be moved to environment two, and we are just erasing everything from environment one. We are making it clean, no more change data and nothing will be there in that. And when this quarter three starts, we'll just dump all the data and code from environment two to environment one, and we'll clean up all environment two thing. We have a sufficient time of 3 months to identify all the junk data and removing that junk data from our systems, so which will provide us good quality test data. So this is one of the best practice, but it is a costly practice because we need two environments. Having two environments requires a lot of money. So this can be one of the practice. But it is a costlier one, but it will provide you good quality test data, which will provide us very good comfort level in as part of testing. So test data management plays an important role. But if you have a junk data in your system, that will give you some unnecessary results, and you won't be confident about your testing of that particular application. Test data management, we'll talk about it. We'll talk about the test data management tools also. There are some in-house built tools available, or you at a basic level you can use an Excel sheet wherein you will track all the test data, like which SSN you have used for particular test case and all. So all these details you can track it using Excel, or you can have a tool developed in-house. Test data management is another section as part of test plan. And the next one is the test environment. So here you will talk about which environment you are going to testing, whether it's a Windows operating system or Macintosh or mainframes environment. So which operating system and which technologies, and what are the tools you are going to use as part of testing. When I say tools, it's not about testing tools. It is about your business tools. Like if you are working on Facets application, Facets is one of the healthcare related tools. So if you are working on that, your environment will be Facets application. So that could be your environment. And if you are working on a web page, if your application is a web page, then your environment will be web application. So like that you will draft the details about your testing environment. If you have a web application, your testing URL will be different, your actual production URL will be different, and the development URL will be different. So you will draft all those details here. So your testing URL will be your testing environment. So like that you will draft the details about testing environment. And then the next section is the communication approach. This one we had in test strategy as well. So communication approach is how you will be communicating the things happening around your testing. So if you are sending a diary status report, how you will be sending, whether you will be sending in an email or you are tracking that in a SharePoint, or you will be having a call and providing the status. So there will be n number of ways to provide the status. So the idea is you will write down how you are providing the status here. So it's not just about status, it's about if you get a if you need a clarification on requirement document at a later point of stage, how you will be communicating, whether you will be raising a defect through quality center or you'll be just sending an email. So it depends on your project standards. So communication approach, where you will list out whether it's an email communication or a phone communication, or whether it's a meeting or a discussion. So how you are going to communicate the things happening in your testing lifecycle. So communication approach, and then you talk about testing tools. So these tools can be your automation tools. Excel, Microsoft Excel is also a tool that you can use as part of testing. And QTP, Selenium, or any other tool that you are using as part of testing, all these things will be listed here. So that's about all the sections that we have as part of our test plan. The major sections that will that you should be taking care of is the test scope, the objective, assumptions, and the test schedule and resources. These are the four. Okay, these are the four sections that will differentiate what a test plan is. The rest of the things, they are pretty much common. If you take any project plan also, the rest of the things will be same. But for testing, these four sections are unique. The four sections are test scope, test objective, assumptions, and then the test schedule and resources. So in strategy also, you will be having communication approach, but you won't be having test schedule and resources. So this differentiates your test plan and strategy documents. And it is not mandatory to have two different documents. You can have a single document which is called test plan, and you can incorporate those sections that are there in test strategy into test plan. It depends solely on the convenience of the project team. So if they wanted two different documents, they can have two different. If the management decides to have a single document wherein all the details will be there, it's fine, you can have it. It depends on the project and the organization standards. Any questions on test plan sections and the details we are covering as part of these sections? Do you have any questions? Okay, I have a question. When exactly we are going to stop making the changes to test plan? We said test plan should be flexible, and we should be able to make changes at any point of time. When we can say that we are not going to make any more changes? Anyone? Hello. Hello.
I think the change is ongoing, because if there's any change in the requirement, then they have to change the case plan again. So until the product is final, I don't think they'll stop.
Yeah. In the release. Mm-hmm. Till we release the product, the test plan will stay the same. Will be flexible. So you should keep the test plan as a dynamic document until you release a particular application. If you are getting any after production defects or post production related issues, then you will develop a new test plan for such things. But this test plan will be live and will be dynamic till that release is happening. So you are right on that. So if you are good, if you are having good understanding on test plan and test strategy, then it's very easy, and you will be having good control on your testing activities and all. So first thing is you should be clear about the differences between strategy and plan. Do you have any questions on this? You can ask now, or just after the session, just Google for some of the test plans available there. There are so many different formats and templates available outside. And when you join an organization, they may have a different kind of template. But basically, they'll cover only these details. At a layman point of view, these are the four items they'll be covering. When you talk about the terminologies and vocabulary, these are the things that will be there in your test plan. So, are you clear so far? Or do you have any questions? Okay, if you're clear about it, tomorrow we'll look at the differences between test strategy and test plan. So that will give us clear picture on that. I'll just give one day time, because you just go about the differences and see the templates and try to note down what exactly we are covering as part of strategy and as part of plan. And tomorrow we will discuss about the differences and some of the testing techniques we will be using as part of testing. So tomorrow's topic would be on the differences between strategy and plan, and we talk about black box and white box testing techniques. If you are clear on test planning and test strategy, then you should be good to go about the execution. Alright, if you don't have any questions, then we are good to finish the session for today, and we will meet tomorrow. Thank you for joining.
Thank you.